Hello, Thomas. Can you hear me? This is Vangelis.
Yes, I can hear you. I can hear
Hello,
you.
Thomas. Can
So
you
you are
give me
there.
the
It's good. Huh?
privileges to, huh?
I give you already the presentation. You have still
Yeah. Do
4 minutes, huh?
you
Good.
hear
Yeah,
me
but
too? Because I have a really professional assistant, I need
Oh,
to.
for security reasons. Wait. Yes. Now
You know,
you should be. You're there?
okay.
Angeles? In theory, you should be now the presenter. Yeah. I see the presentation.
Oh.
But
Thomas, do you hear me?
I can hear you and
Ah,
I see
great.
the presentation and presentation mode. I think you solved the problems with the security issues of your computer.
But we have problem with sound, Thomas.
Yes, but it's me or it's
Yeah, this
Vangelis?
is true.
No,
No, it's Vangelis.
No, it's you, Thomas.
It's your computer again.
Oh. Really?
No, now it's better.
No,
Now it sounds
can you
better.
hear me? Okay, I will start singing and tell me if I have.
It's
Yeah, it
okay.
sounds better. Okay, so there's no need to sing.
Try
Okay.
also to share your camera or you will do it without? See?
Oh, let me check.
Great,
Oh,
great,
can you hear? Can you
great.
see me also, huh?
Now I can see
All
you. I
right.
can see you.
Also, so you have sound and vision at the moment, and also my presentation.
Yes, of course. I have your presentation, I see your face, and I hear your voice.
Oh my goodness.
But we have still 2 minutes, huh? That
Okay.
the computer can come
Yes.
back. How are you doing?
Very well at the moment. I don't know
You're
you.
at home.
Yeah.
On
Yes,
Friday
I'm at
last week,
home.
you were in the office.
But
But now
Vangelis.
you're at home at the moment. Yeah.
Vangelis, I realized that you didn't joke last time when you said the about the earthquake.
Yeah, it wasn't a joke. Actually, we had a strong earthquake, as you saw.
Yeah.
I know that I have seen it
Ridiculous.
later in the
Yeah.
news. Yeah.
And I'm just scared now to go to the office and open the Go to webinar because of
Sorry,
this earthquake.
you
Okay,
have
that's why I
colleagues.
came
It's not
home
initiated by GoToWebinar.
now.
No. Yeah, not
Yeah.
responsible for that. No. But
Yes, indeed.
you are prepared. Let's see. You have still 1 minute, huh? If you need to make some preparations or something, a
Okay,
coffee,
I'll drink
water,
some water. I'm drinking some
and
water.
water. Okay, that's good. That's good. My one is empty, but I can go directly to take a new one. When you start with the presentation, I have half an hour to go.
Well.
Okay, then I think, let me short check. It's 1 minute, but I hope everyone is back. Then I would like to say that we will have now the second part of our conference related to the valorization of volatile fatty acids. There we will have a presentation from Vangelis Toupakas. Vangelis is a professor at the National Technical University of Athens, and he's a quite experienced biotechnologist. Yeah, he is the head of the Laboratory for Industrial Biotechnology and Biocatalysis. And he will speak now about microalgae production of omega-3 fatty acids, micro production of omega-3 fatty acids, the role of microalgae in the volatile project. Vangelis, I give you the floor. Yeah?
Thank you, Thomas, for the nice introduction. And I will be the last to complete the range of products produced from the volatile fatty acid platform that was already mentioned by the previous speakers. This is a work done by three partners, National Technical University of Athens, where I belong, Technalia and Biozoom. And so before I start talking about the success story, if I can say, of making omega-3 from volatile fatty acids, and the role of microalgae in this story, I will start an introduction on what is omega-3. So omega-3 fatty acids are fatty acids, which means that we are having carboxylic acid, organic acid, which is an aliphatic chain, which might be short, like in case of volatile fatty acids, or long. And we could have, for instance, double bonds. So we are talking about polyunsaturated fatty acids. And in case that we are having a double bond in the third position, in the third carbon counting from the methyl group, then we are having the omega-3 fatty acids. So where we can find these acids, for instance, we can have the alpha-linolenic acid, which is plant-based omega-3. So we can find it easily in olive oil and seeds, while the eicosapentaenoic acid, which is called also EPA, the abbreviation, and docosahexaenoic acid, DHA, could be found in marine environments, and specifically in fish, seafood, for instance, or microalgae. So there are a lot of benefits in consuming omega-3. For instance, we can have we can deal with cardiovascular diseases like arrhythmia, stroke, and high blood pressure, fight against depression, rheumatoid arthritis, while there is a lot of interest in the field of neural development, especially in infants. That's why, according to the Child Health Foundation, omega-3 like DHA and omega-6 like arachidonic acid are used as food additives in such formulas since the 90s. So it's something really important. Of course, there is a lot of literature supporting this specific beneficial effect of omega-3. For instance, we see in this paper, a recent paper that states that the consumption of EPA and DHA, for instance, results in the reduced risk of heart attacks. And of course, there are some papers, there are a lot of papers on this justification of the use of these omega-3 fatty acids that influence in a positive way the infant neurodevelopment. So we see here in this global map, we see with different coloring the levels of omega-3 in blood, and where we can see that unfortunately we have most of the cases we have low to very low blood levels of omega-3, which is unfortunately connected to a high rate of cardiovascular diseases. So it seems that there is a connection between this, and that's why food industry is really interested in adding such omega-3 in various products, like, for example, as I said before, in infant food, infant formulas, as well for adult diet supplements in cheese, in yogurt, and so on. And also there is a big list of big industries in the field that are working on research, development, manufacturing, and marketing of single-cell oil polyunsaturated fatty acids, like in case of omega-3. So there is a big interest. So this is one of the target compounds that also Volatile Project aim in producing it in a sustainable way. So where we can find, for instance, the EPA and DHA, as I said before, we need to go fishing. It's a marine derived omega-3. So we should search for wild harvest fish and seafood or farm fish, but there are several issues that we need to consider. For instance, the biggest issue is that the current global fish harvest of 120 million tons fish per year is insufficient to supply the daily recommended intake of omega-3 fatty acids for the world population. So We are so many on the planet, so facing in that way that we are doing, we are having a big issues in this field, so we need to take care of that. Also, fish oil is not suitable for vegetarians or even vegans, so there is also an issue, so people doesn't eat fish, so they cannot take that from specifically these two omega-3, the EPA and DHA. And also the odor makes it as an attractive for consumption. Also, the existence of large quantities of saturated as well as omega-6 fatty acids make the purification expensive. So this is another issue that we need to take into account. And last but not least, the fish oil includes both EPA and DHA, which is undesirable for specific applications, like in case of we have seen papers and there is a lot of literature around growth retardation to neonates, to young children. So we don't want to have both omega-3 in their formula, in their diet. So it's really important to have one of them. So let's see how we can have omega-3, how omega-3 are being accumulated in fish. So what is really surprising is that we say that okay, omega-3 is found in fish, but fish are not having the mechanism, the biological, the metabolism to produce omega-3. So omega-3 is being accumulated from microalgae. So the producers, the natural producers of omega-3, EPA, DHA, are microalgae. So microalgae are food for zooplankton, and zooplankton is food for fish larvae, and fish larvae is food for bigger fish, and bigger fish are food for us. So at the end of the day, having all this long food chain, we have in our diet omega-3 through microalgae. And of course, we can shortcut this food chain and directly get the omega-3 to our dish, to our diet, directly from microalgae. Since microalgae are the primary producers of omega-3, as I said before, while fish cannot produce omega-3 by themselves, they just accumulate them from the food chain that I showed before. So there are a lot of benefits in microbial omega-3. First of all, vegetarians can have this kind of omega-3. Since we are not considering microalgae as animals, we are having a shorter life cycle, so that means that we are having higher production rates. Easier purification processes, since we are having only one omega-3 produced, this is really important. There is no need to have a really strong, difficult, and expensive downstream processing. As Marcus said before, this is a really expensive part of biotechnological bioprocesses. There are no heavy metals included. This is something important. When we consume large amount of fish nowadays, we accumulate mercury in our blood, so we avoid also this negative issue. And the most important is that we are having a solution to the problem of limited marine fish stocks. So we are having a sustainable production of omega-3 by using microbial production of omega-3 fatty acids. So this is the our target. This is our goal in volatile projects. So the previous speakers, they nicely described how we have this VFA platform and how we can make these different products like PHA, single cell oil, and now we are talking about omega-3 fatty acids. So how we deal with this issue, as I said, we have a joint effort from three partners. First of all, together with Technalia and the team of Thomas, we did a literature review where we tried to find which microalgae species can valorize the VFA and produce high added value compounds like polyunsaturated fatty acids or carotenoids. And that was our first publication in our project in 2017 in Fermentation Journal, where we had this joint publication between Technalia and NTUA on this issue, on the utilization of volatile fatty acids from microalgae. And then we end up with a short list of microalgae species that are able to produce omega-3 and specifically DHA. So we picked as our working horses the Schizohydrum limacinum and Cryptocodinum coni. A few words about these species, starting from with the Schizohydrum. It's an heterotrophic marine protist, not exactly microalgae, that belongs to Labritomycota. It's able to grow on glucose, fructose, and glycerol. And what is really important in this species is that is having a GRAS status, which means that it's generally recognized as safe for use. And of course, it's a DHA-rich ingredient that industry is using it for feeding broiler chickens and laying hen feed. So it's a really important material. Cryptocodinum coni also is a really interesting dinoflagellate. So as you see on the left, there is some, let's say, legs in this microorganism. So on the right corner, you see the view of our microalgae swimming happily in our microscope. It's really fast and really volatile. Flexible, I can say. It can produce high lipids in its dry biomass. There is a high percentage of DHA, and in literature is known to grow on glucose, acetate, and ethanol. So a few words about their metabolism. Like oleaginous fungi, we are having the the transfer of acetic of volatile fatty acids like acetate and butyrate through the membrane that it's being transformed to acetyl-CoA or butyryl-CoA, and these are transferred to mitochondria directly or through the glyoxylate cycle. And inside mitochondria, when we are having an excess of energy produced, then a really important enzyme, which is a regulating enzyme, the ATP citrate lyase, can, shown here, can move, transfer the carbon as acetyl-CoA towards the production, the biosynthesis of fatty acids in lipid bodies that play the role of energy storage. So that happens through this fatty acid synthetic pathway where the acetyl-CoA is being transformed to malonyl-CoA and then go into this cycle and being upgraded to up to C18 fatty acids. And there's some evidence in literature where Schizohydrum and Cryptocodinum coni is having a combination of this fatty acid synthetic pathway together with the omega-6 and omega-3 pathway in order to transform C18 fatty acid towards the production of DHA. Of course, things are not clarified. We have some transcriptome analysis that prove the existence of various desaturases and elongases for the DHA biosynthesis. So, we, as partners, involved in these two specific species. So NTUA worked exclusively with Cryptocodinum coni, while Technalia worked with Schizohydrum limacinum. In the next slides, I will give you an outline of the optimization of the fermentation protocol that we followed. And something similar was also was carried out as a work from the part of Technalia and Biozone. So first of all, we tried to understand if this species, Cryptocodinum coni, can utilize different volatile fatty acids that are present in the dark fermentation permeate, other than acetate, which is really known in literature. So we checked if this species can consume, utilize, for instance, propionate and butyrate, and that was true. So for the first time in literature, we proved that this strain is able to utilize all these three volatile fatty acids. All the experiments that were carried out in batch fermentations in shaking flasks, as we can see on this photo, where we had this phenomenon, when we had the consumption of VFAs, which are acids, of course, then we had the rise of pH, which is something expected, of course. So we have a rise of pH from 6.5 up to approximately 9 that inhibited fermentation, and also we had the coagulation of the cells, which is something really nice when we want to end our fermentation and harvest the cells without consuming much energy, like in case that we run centrifugation. In order to increase biomass and to deal with this pH rise, this pH inhibition due to the rise of pH, of course, we end up with this solution. We worked on fed batch fermentations using these pH axostats, where you see here, these are our 2-liter bioreactor where we control the pH. We are having a pH probe inside, and when we have the rise of pH, then the bioreactor automatically starts adding the acid, and not just an ordinary acid like in organic acid. We are adding the volatile fatty acids, so we are having the control of pH while we are adding carbon source in our system. So it's a really efficient system. So these are our system. The New Brunswick Bioflow bioreactors, where we add feeding material, the VFAs. This is the synthetic medium, for instance, and on the right you see this yellow colored permeate, which is a bit smelly, where we added the permeate that was delivered from Technalia. So we found a nice growth of biomass when we use acetate, propionate, or butyrate as feeding medium through this fed batch fermentation system. And also, except of biomass, we had also the production of fatty acids, and of course, the production of DHA, that was our target. And these results were published in Applied Energy Journal in 2019. That was our second publication on this field for omega-3 production. So after that, we optimized the nutrient growth. So we went back to batch fermentation just to do a fast screening on different nitrogen sources like yeast extract, ammonium sulfate, sodium nitrate, and so on. Different range of temperature, starting from 20 degrees up to 30 degrees. And also different range of initial carbon to nitrogen ratio, which is a really important parameter in order to stress the cells and produce more fatty acids. So we found these optimal conditions, and what was really important in this case is that by changing the yeast extract source, we can have a drop in the cost of nutrient growth. Growth medium up to 75 times, considering the price of yeast extract and ammonium sulfate from alibaba.com on June of 2019, where we did this search, for instance. So just changing the nitrogen source, we can really make our medium really cheap. And this is really important when we have a bio-waste, which is really something really cheap, so with no value. Also, we did the experiments using this growth with using the dark fermentation permeate as feeding stream, using again our system, and due to the neutral pH that this permeate has, we did the acidification with hydrochloric acid down to pH 2.5. And we published our results this year in 2020 in renewable energy, where we found, surprisingly, that the control reactor that had the yeast extract as nitrogen source gave better, higher DHA compared to the optimized medium. Of course, that was easily found what was the reason why, since the total fatty acids and the DHA percentage is nearly the same between the two fermentations. However, when we add yeast extract, we don't add just nitrogen, but also we add a lot of carbon. So in that case, the control reactor had higher biomass recovery that resulted at the end on highest DHA recovery. So of course, as I said before, yeast extract is really expensive. So, and someone can say, okay, let's switch to ammonium sulfate, even if we have less biomass produced, but we have a really cheap production. Also, we did some experiments on the optimization of the fed batch fermentation. In that case, the last year we were really happy in our lab that we have purchased this system. This is the BioExplorer 100. It's a mini fermentation systems where we can do comparative fermentations up to eight different bioreactors with a working volume of 150 mLs. So in that case, we examine two different nitrogen sources, and specifically the yeast extract and ammonium sulfate, with different carbon to nitrogen ratio, different temperature profiles, while we had the ability to use the concentrated dark fermentation permeate delivered by Technalia. That was really important. We had, of course, in low amounts, so we are able to work with that in these small bioreactors. Of course, what we found is that yeast extract, again, was the favorite nitrogen source for the production of biomass, while the high carbon to nitrogen ratio facilitates the DHA accumulation. And also we found that the optimum temperature for the production of DHA was 23 degrees. So we have a stress of the microalgae species when we have a low nitrogen and low temperature. That was really nice. And of course, we used the concentrated permeate delivered by Technalia, where we finally produced around 12 grams per liter of dry cell weight of biomass and a relatively good total fatty acid. Of course, we could increase this total fatty acid content if we would increase the fermentation time. However, we had a small problem in the acidification of the concentrated permeate. And that's why we couldn't acidify it a lot in order to have a better pH adjusting capacity. So unfortunately, we had a high rate of feeding. So we increased a lot the concentration of VFAs inside the medium. And at the end, we had this conversion yield, which was really good. And also, we worked on a larger scale, not just 1 liter or 150 mLs. We also provided biomass on our 15-liter bioreactor, since we had also as a partner the task to do all the work for the downstream processing and how to optimize the destruction of microalgae cells in order to efficiently get the most of the fatty acids in the final product. And something similar was also carried out by Technalia and Biozone on Schizohydrum limacinum for the production of omega-3 fatty acids from this species. I will show you only two slides from them, the final production. So they carried out fermentation on a 5-liter steel tank reactor, where they had a similar production of dry cell weight, around 11 for example, using the synthetic analog or the real VFA permeate with a nice production of DHA. And also they upscaled with up to 30 liter using this diluted oxygen stat fed batch fermenter, where the carbon source regime was based on the decrease of the stirring speed that happens due to the automatic increase of the dissolved oxygen at the end of the fermentation. So due to this specific automated process, we had the production of the higher production compared to 5 liter by reactor, up to 14 dry weight grams of dry weight of biomass. So, and a really nice production of DHA. So this is the end of my presentation. It seems that the volatile project was a success story. We really did something unique. We utilized something that is really difficult, bio-waste, and through the volatile fatty acid platform, we end up with a series of products, like really valuable products like single cell oil, like PHA, and also omega-3. At that point, I would like to say special thanks to the leading person of my group, Angelina Halima, that did all the work from our part, and together with Anthi Karnauri, that worked mostly with lignocellulosics, not that part that was not related, of course, with volatile, as well as with the project students, Angeliki Hatzidaki and George Taxidis, my INDA BioCat team, and of course, Marina Stramarku from the Laboratory of Process Analysis and Design, supervised by Professor Krokida, that did all the work on the of the downstream processing. That I didn't say anything about that. Of course, I didn't have time. There was also a lot of work carried out on, as I said before, on the breaking the cells and how we could efficiently get all this omega-3. And of course, I would like to thank people from Technalia, our boss, Thomas Dietrich, and his group with Laura and Carlota, that provide us the valuable and smelly dark fermentation permeate, and of course, Biosyn. So thank you for your attention. Hopefully you were able to hear me, and if you want any questions to ask, I'm happy to respond.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the very interesting presentation. Also, I all the time, if I see something new, I understand more things. Also, if you are all the time involved in the aspects, that's quite good. Yes, I have seen there's a question from Edward. I'm now, he said, did Vangelis buy the yeast extract from Alibaba? The cost reduction is extreme, but is he sure that it's the same quality?
No, I didn't. I didn't do that. I just checked the market to see how cheaper this fermentation could go. I mean, no. The yeast extract was the well-known, you know, for research, which is much more expensive, of course. Yeah. But I just saw the prices just to understand, you know, because if you want to make a fermentation of, you know, 1 cubic meter or more, then you have a really low cost. Yes.
The price is reduced because you are ordering directly significantly more yeast extract than only for 5 liters, 10 liters or 20 liters. Yeah. Okay. You go back to the slide or what you're...
No. Yes, I just the button of to end the presentation mode.
Okay. Are there any more questions? No, it looks like, as I said also before, if you have further questions, you can also write them there in the question application, and also you can contact Vangelis also directly. So if there's any more, if not, then wait, now I think it's something. Jochen said thanks. Great done. Okay. Okay, then thanks, Mangelis, and then shift on to the next presentation. So the after we had this morning a little bit the framework, afterwards the specific work package on the biomass transformation via our volatile fatty acid platform, and then after this the valorization schemes the valorization schemes towards to biopolyester, single cell oil, and to omega-3 fatty acids by microalgae. We are coming now to the bioeconomy support, how it's called in our agenda. That means we will start with en route to standardization, the SEN workshop agreement, IFA volatile. It will be done by our colleagues Jochen Michels from Dechema, who presented already this morning. And he will be supported by Christian Grunewald from Dean. So they will both give the next presentation. Jochen, in theory, you should be now the presenter.
Yeah, in practical, I hope I'm too. Short sound check with Christian.
Right.
Can you hear me? Hello.
Yeah, great. So,
I can also see you. Only Jochen is
Yeah, I'm not going to share my screen. I think it is a question of bandwidth. So,
okay.
So and this is the bridge to escape from here. So.
Okay. So I will let you know the.